in an effort to help you keep...
Hello. I'm Jonathan Ross. You know, the longest I've ever been kept waiting for an interviewee was the time Madonna had me pacing up and down for 2 full hours while she put the finishing touches to her makeup, of course. Tom Jones had me waiting for 1 hour and 15 minutes once, but then he was stuck in traffic, so that's a legitimate excuse. Barry Manilow was 15 minutes early, which, let's face it, is just desperate. But I can see no good reason why Chris Isaak should keep me waiting even the 5 minutes that he has so far. I mean, I've known this guy for years, and he's a very entertaining man and a very, very talented singer and songwriter. Blue Hotel is one of my favorite songs of all time. Wicked Games was a great hit all around the world. He's been in movies. But even so, I mean, I'd booked a room here for the two of us and got him his favorite drink. Got extra peanuts put in the room. Well, he better be extra nice to me, that's all.
I'm glad I can make it too,
Chris. Now I know you and I admire you from afar, as you know, and that's why I've lured you here to my little motel room today. But I know very little.
Sounds kind of sordid.
Well, let's see how the interview progresses.
I admired you from afar.
But I know very little, of course, about the young Chris. Chris Isaak as a small person. Chris Isaak as a foaming individual.
I'm a foaming individual.
You were born where? Stockton, a place called Stockton. Now where
Stockton,
was that?
California.
And this was called Fat City, I believe.
Some people call it that, but we just call it Stockton, those who live there. It's about 100 miles northeast, I guess, of San Francisco, and it's a very kind of, for a farm town, it's very upbeat.
And a small population, would there be?
Now it's a bigger population. They have, it's just kind of spread out. When I was growing up, it was the big things to work at was the box factory where my dad worked. There's a port, there's a lot of farms. And then there's prisons. We got a lot of prisons right around there. You know, it's a good kind of community to be in. You
nice.
Got prisons right there, you know what I mean?
You don't have to travel to go to jail. And growing up, was this the kind of idyllic childhood that one would imagine a young American boy having in a small town?
Yes. It was pretty idyllic for me. I had two older brothers, and it's a...
And what were the what are your other brothers do now? Are they older than you, younger than you?
Well, they're in the local prison system there.
Yep.
No, I got one older brother. They're both living in Stockton still. One brother, he's got a wife and kid, and the other brother is still looking. He's having auditions, I guess, and they're working and living in Stockton.
And what kind of child were you then? How did you fit in the whole family scene? Were you a...
Different than other kids. You know, I think it was marked, even at an early age, was kind of something special about me.
Just, a glow.
Not at all, just pretty average, and well, I guess average would be giving me the benefit of the doubt in some things, but... just, you know, like everybody else, going to school and hoping to get a job when I got out. And only at like the last minute did I get involved in any kind of show business or music or anything like that.
So event that changed the course of your days then? Why did you decide to suddenly pick up the guitar and learn? Or what was it first, the guitar or the accordion?
Guitar. My older brother played guitar, Nick, and he played all kind of country western around the house. So I grew up listening to him play country western music, and when he would go to school, you know, he'd tell me, "Don't touch my guitar, I'll break your face." I'd say, "Okay, Nick, I'm going to play your guitar anyway." He'd go to school, and then immediately I said, "I'm going to play his guitar, I'll learn to play this thing." So he would go, and I'd play his guitar all day and put it back exactly where it was. And, you know, one day I was playing his guitar and set it back, and I'm walking around the house, and I heard something go, "Dwang!" You know, sometimes guitars just break a string, you know, I mean, it just snaps.
You weren't near it.
I wasn't anywhere near it, but I had been playing it all the time. He came home and he goes, "You've been playing my guitar." I got nailed.
Now, if we talk about your singing, initially at least, after the first and second album, there were a lot of comparisons made between you and, in particular, Roy Orbison. That was the name that was thrown around, which I guess on the one hand must have been flattering, but on the other hand, it must have driven you crazy just a little bit, didn't it?
I was surprised that people made that comparison, you know, pleasantly. I thought it was a real nice comparison for me. And it's really nice if people compare me to those, like to Elvis or Orbison. And I ripped off a lot of stuff from them, you know.
There's obviously some influence there, yeah. That's.
I ripped off a lot of their stuff because I really like their stuff, and you know.
But you see,
music.
If I can just pull you up on something here, you should never admit to ripping something off. What you're doing is you're paying homage to it.
Yeah, paying homage. I was heavily influenced by my tribute to Chris Isaak's tribute to.
In a lot of your stuff, there's a sense of longing. There's a sense of, you know, in the romantic stuff, there's a sense of pining for someone, perhaps. Yeah. And I think many people have wondered, myself included, whether there is one specific person or a small select group of specific people that you are thinking of when you're
what
writing
kind of
these.
What kind of a combination? There's one small select specific person.
No, there were two things there. One specific person or a small select group of specific people.
No, there's one small select specific
okay, one
person.
One small, very specific.
She's kind of small and she's select.
She's selective.
Yeah, no, she's select. And I think, so I have somebody that particular to me.
And is this someone who you had some time with and now there is no more time to be had together? Or this
no,
is someone
things look like they're going to go good.
So you're with this person?
I'm not going to jinx it, but yeah, no. I'm with this person.
So I'm curious, but when you're singing a song like Wicked Game?
That was then. This is now. My next album is going to be a lot more upbeat. The next album is going to be, sounds like Chris Isaak meets Brian Wilson. You know, My Day in the Sun.
Yeah. Now the clothes, you're dressed very casual. And almost low-key way today.
Well, it was clean. I didn't have a bunch of clothes with me. I was just in town, so.
There was no hint of criticism there. I'm pleased to see you looking smart and well turned out.
Okay.
But on stage.
No snappy jacket.
No snappy jacket.
Of course, is that an endangered species there? Can we get a shot of that for the
Well, if it isn't, then I want my money back. But on stage.
What are you telling me, though? It's good for kids to be able to see this.
I have a theory that if you're going to wear an animal, wear one that they can't see alive anymore, because then at least they can enjoy it secondhand.
So school kids, now that this is actually probably, this might be actually the last one of that species, they could actually come up to Jonathan and say, I've never seen one, but this is the last one, isn't it?
And I can say, look, and this is moving like it would have done in real life.
Do they actually grow with the little dice hand buttons?
Yeah. That's why they're so sought after by hunters. But let me go back to asking something here, because I've completely forgotten what it was going to be. Now I was going to talk to you about your clothes. And here you are, you're dressed in a smart, well-pressed, but low-key way. But on stage, last time I saw you performing...
For lounging or singing, Chris is casual at home or in the office.
But you had on the finest suit I've ever seen in my entire life, made entirely of mirrored glass.
Yeah.
Like a big, you were like alive, a living mirror ball at a discotheque.
Yeah, that's what it is exactly. It's like a suit and it's got like... hundreds, and that suit weighs like 25 pounds. People go, gee, that's a nice looking suit. You're sweating a lot. And I'm like, it weighs like 25 pounds to put on, doesn't breathe at all, you can't sit down, and you can only bend your arm about like just enough to play guitar.
And this suit, because at one stage, I believe, your mother helped you design your stage wear.
At one point, this one was my own bad idea. But I'll tell you why I did it, because I wanted to get it was a desperate cry for attention. I think, we're playing, you know, going out on tour and stuff, and a lot of times we would open or we'd be on a bill with people who had a whole bunch of money, and they would have, you know, bring in the laser lights, and, you know, we'll have the laser lights behind us, we'll have my face, and then we'll have the big screen, we'll come up out of the floor, then I'll go out over the audience in a balloon, and they'd go, Chris, what do you have? You know, I have a sparkler. I hold that up, you know. It's like, so I had to have something, so I thought, well, I can afford this suit, and then I can carry that with me.
And most of them, apart from the mirror one, you could wear off stage as well, so you have that.
Well, actually, the mirror one I could wear off stage, too.
There's no sitting
Sometimes,
down.
Sometimes, you know, you just want the attention.
Yeah, you just want to walk out there and grab them.
What, oh, this thing?
Disgust?
Lust.
Oh, lust.
I believe that you have recently, and this has been going on for some time, in order to get into ball games free, you offer your services to sing the American national anthem.
Yeah, okay, it's a scam. All right, so what of it? They get something, I get something. They got a couple of hot dogs. I mean,
but that always struck me as being one of the weirdest songs, because I can't quite work out what's being sung normally.
You know, wait a minute.
No, but it's a strange, what is it, what
when
are the words?
When you're running down our flag, you're getting on the fighting side of me, boy.
Let's hear a bit of, what is the American one called? It's called the Stars and Stripes Forever.
Yeah, and it's big, you know, ho, say, can.
But what are the words involved in this? I get lost. Say, can you see by the dawn's early light?
Yeah.
And then what's the...
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous night or the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
See, what does that mean?
It means that they're watching that flag through a fight, and they're watching it, and they're taking courage from the fact that that flag is still staying up there.
Yeah, see, now I'm educated now. So you thought I was being disparaging.
You know something? They only sing a little bit of that. If they let me, I'd sing the whole damn song, because there's other verses to it which they don't sing, and most people don't know. I mean, I don't know them by heart, but there's like six other verses. The verses they sing talk about the flag, watching it, and then it says, in the morning we watched in the dawn's early light, look, the flag's still there, it's still going. And it's like kind of a big triumphant ending. But there's verses in the middle that are like blood and guts.
So there's
like verses in the middle that, like, you know, and we would go on to defend this flag even if our arms were cut off, and you go ahead and shoot me in the eye, I'll still, you know, it goes on. I mean, it's rough.
Chris, I know this is completely beyond your control, this kind of thing, and you won't have seen it because you very wisely don't read your press, but you've become this object of, what's the phrase I'm looking for here to be polite?
Disgust?
Lust.
Oh, lust.
But in a certain section of the population, a specific...
Male prisoners?
Some male prisoners, I suspect, heavyset guys. And
yeah, boy, come into my cell.
No, thanks. Just cleaning up.
But you have become a lust object for people. I'm not going to get gender specific here because there's no need to be in this modern age.
That's
but there
right.
you go. And you are now.
Why limit ourselves? Huh?
Exactly. Life is just a big bowl of cherries. Let's just reach in and pick a handful. But which one? No, not which one. I'm not going to go down that track.
but which
is
one?
Is this hard to deal with, the fact that you think, well, these are people who don't know me, and they don't know the real Chris Isaak. They will do after watching this show, but that up until now they haven't known the real Chris Isaak, and yet they have sexual feelings towards you.
God bless them.
Is that it? Is that all you're going to say?
Yeah, God bless them.
Well, let me press you on this, and this may well not make the final show. I don't know, but I've always felt, and I feel comfortable enough in your presence to ask you this, but. Let's say,
and you feel comfortable enough about your maleness, right?
Yeah, I'm happy. I'm secure. Conceivably, people of either sex have masturbated when thinking of Chris Isaak.
Cut.
No, I'm just curious here.
Ouch.
Yeah, well, no, I know this.
I think we're getting to know more about you than we want to.
No, I'm not talking about me. So I
this
can is honestly
where,
say,
is this
Chris,
the
I never.
Same mouth you used to kiss your mother. Come on,
Chris. I never have done.
I'm sorry, Mom.
Chris,
I didn't know it was going to be like.
But
this.
Let's just listen. Let's just think about this for a second, because
what was that song I was singing? Let's see.
Oh, you.
Father, alone.
We're back to the gospel.
Father, alone.
Okay, I overstepped the line. I take it all back. We
you
can go.
You know, you ought to sing one of those songs yourself. It'd be good for your soul.
Well, I'm just curious.
You.
Here you are. It's a phenomenon of the modern age. We broadcast the media, your face, your image is put up there. And that, by the way...
Oh, I thought you were going to say masturbation was a phenomenon of the modern age.
No, that's been around for years.
Way back.
But let's change the subject, sort of. But the video for Wicked Game, now that was a sexy video. That was a sexy video.
Yeah, you know, people said that was a sexy video. And I'll tell you the truth. I saw that video, we made it, and I flew from Hawaii and went directly, like, by all these connecting flights. That was the longest flight I ever did. All these little hip-hops get back to the hotel room, and the tape is there. They'd already, like, finished, you know.
In the time that you...
Yeah. They beat me there with the tape. I get the tape, I put it in, and I looked at it, and I thought, I like the video, but I don't think...
Assume there's a degree of acting going on there. And when you're doing a movie, like the big movie you've just finished, the Little Buddha film,
yeah.
Is there any difference in the way you prepare and do things in that?
You know, doing a video is pretty straightforward. You know, you go there, it's a lot more, I think, the videos. It's funny, Bertolucci, the director on the Little Buddha, I said, you got any ideas for a video? And I said, watch MTV and stuff, look at these videos, and what do you think? And he looked and he said, I think all the videos are very ego. Like, it's all ego-centered, everything is ego-centered. And I thought, yeah, it is. It's all about singers, you know, looking into the camera and looking. You know, look at me, I look good, or, you know, look at me, I'm with this beautiful woman, or, you know what I mean? Whereas, like, when you're in those films, at least in the films I've been in, I'm not the star attraction of the thing, you're just part of the whole thing.
It's an ensemble piece.
Yeah. And even if you, I think in a good film like Bertolucci or something, like, you know, it's not just about your ego. It's about some there's an idea and stuff. Videos are pretty much, you know, comb your hair as good as you can and then show up for 3 minutes.
I suppose that inherently in the difference between them is a video is a tool to sell a record to the buying public, the eager buying public.
Yeah, or else to make yourself an image of lust.
Yeah, well, I didn't create this for you, Chris. You've done it yourself. This
it was
is a cooler.
My idea.
It's a cooler you've painted yourself into.
It was my idea.
I'm just bringing you the news from the people. Let me ask you about this film then, Little Buddha, which I am looking forward to with some degree of expectation, which is due out quite soon, I suppose. But it seems like a curious plot. You play a Seattle person who
I
then...
I play like a yuppie in it. I keep saying I think it's kind of like a yuppie, because like he's responsible, and he wears suits, and he's got a nice house. It's all, you know, he's got a real good, he's driving a nice new car, and he's married to Bridget Fonda, and, well, that's not too yuppie, I guess, but he's got a little boy who's 9 years old. A lot of the stuff, you know, they took all the grease out of my hair, very painful process, took 16 hours a day to do that, but, took all the grease out of my hair. Bertolucci kept saying, what can we do with his hair? He looks like a rock star. We must make him different.
That, by the way, is a charming characterization you're doing there. I suspect Bertolucci will be very pleased.
I hope he doesn't see it, because actually Bernardo Bertolucci is a pretty big guy.
What is it, Jesse?
I'm scared, Dad.
Hey, man, I'm scared too. What are we going to tell Mom? She's going to want to hear the end of the story.
You know the guy who breaks the antennas off cars? That's me.
Jonathan Ross presents Chris Isaak.
Your film career, when it first started, it didn't immediately kick in the way one might have thought, because...
Still hasn't.
Well, no, you've got a starring role in a movie that's due out very soon. Yeah. But the first film that I was aware of you in was Married to the Mob, in which you were on screen for... How long?
That one.
Exactly. It was it was a blink and miss, but it was a good...
Drop your popcorn, Miss Chris.
It was a cameo role as a kind of clown killer.
Yeah.
Then followed that with...
got to wear one of those, you know, those clown... collars.
Which now we associate fully with serial killers.
Well, that was at a time when you could legally wear the clown collar without having to go to clown school or actually be certified. And now I think they're a little more strict on that.
They tighten up.
It was fun.
And then you followed that with Silence of the Lambs, in which you were on screen for...
Johnny, hold your fire. We're coming into the car. We're opening the hatch. Watch his hands. If there's any fire, it'll come from us. Affirm.
God.
Slightly longer. No clown suit.
That was Silence of the Lambs was fun. We shot that in the middle, like Pittsburgh in the wintertime, in this Civil War museum that they built actually like not long after the Civil War. And it was really spooky and really dark. People said, oh, what was it like working with Jodie Foster and all these people? And I said, well, you know, those people would walk by and they'd go, you know, hi. And they would, you know, they were busy. They were working.
But have you turned down a lot of film parts? Do you get a lot of really cheesy roles offered, like kind of teenage passage of age movies and coming of age, that kind of thing?
The nice thing about being a musician is I don't have to worry that I'm not going to work. I just say, yeah, that's no good. I'll just keep working.
Hello.
I'm calling you from Portland, Oregon.
It's Regional Chief Gordon Cole calling from Portland, Oregon.
Okay, Gordon.
Oregon!
You don't drink.
No.
You don't do any drugs, including caffeine.
I've had caffeine probably in some stuff. I guess there's caffeine in...
Coca-Cola.
Is there? Yeah. Well, I hardly ever drink caffeine stuff. You know, I have a tough enough time sleeping at night with my conscience as it is.
But what a positive role model you are for the youngsters. No, seriously, this is something which is... We very rarely meet people who are... They're hip and they're cutting edge and you're... As we said, you're an object of lust.
I don't do any of these other things. The only thing is I feel guilty when I say, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I do this stuff, because then people think, oh, he's Pat Boone, he's a real sweet guy. And I feel like, no, I just don't drink, I don't smoke and do that. Yeah. But I have plenty of energy to do other rotten stuff, let me tell you. You know, it's like, you know the guy who breaks the antennas off cars? That's me. I'm the guy.
That's your fix.
Yeah.
That's what you need. Can I prevail upon you for a little bit more of music here? And this is to end the plug in with, so perhaps something which will move me, or perhaps will even move you. Something which you like very deeply, profoundly.
But let me just say,
before you do that, let me just say
thank you for talking to me today, and thank you for joining me here at the hotel. Thanks.
What are you doing on that little screen there?
I'm playing Pac-Man.
Oh, I see.
And I've just won.
Well, I'm trying to think of something nice here.
Am I bothering you this close? Do I want to move?
No, stay right here and sing with me on the high one, will you?
Not bad.
Real good.
That was close.